after the death and resurrection of Jesus, there's this significant conversation that the gospel writer Luke records for us. In fact, I might say that what's recorded in Luke chapter 24 that Luke describes may be the most significant conversation captured in the entire Bible. Jesus, after he rose from the dead, he comes across these two disciples, two followers of his that weren't a part of the original 12, the other followers of his, who had heard of all the things that had happened, all of the chaos that ensued in Jerusalem. They heard about this crowd that rioted, that brought about Jesus' crucifixion. They started to hear on that Sunday about the rumors of Jesus being risen. Some women had come to them and given report of the fact that the tomb was empty. They were confused. They described to the other disciples that Jesus was alive. And so two of these followers of Jesus are leaving Jerusalem, and they're on their way to a town called Emmaus. About a 7-mile journey. And as they're on their way having this conversation, processing all that's taken place in Jerusalem, these two individuals have someone come up to them. And it's Jesus. The interesting detail that Luke, the author, records for us is that Jesus comes across these disciples of his, these followers of his, as they're talking about all of the events that have transpired around Jesus. And Jesus kind of innocently comes up to them in the most undercover way and says to them, so what are you guys talking about? And the two disciples, we're told, are prevented from recognizing that it's Jesus. And they're looking at this man that they can't recognize who he is, and they say things like, have you not heard? Have you been living under a rock? What do you mean? What are you talking about? It's only been the talk of Jerusalem. It's everywhere. It's what everybody's been talking about. It's about Jesus. And they start telling Jesus about what Jesus had just experienced. And they're confused, and they're trying to process through all this, and Jesus is like, tell me more about this, and he kind of entertains them, listens, and hears them out. And then finally it gets to this point where Jesus says to them, don't you believe what all of the Bible, all of the prophets, and all of the law, all of that Moses told you, don't you believe that the Christ would come, suffer, and be glorified? Don't you believe what the Bible has taught all along? And then he says this. I want you to look with me. This is Luke chapter 24. Check out what this says. Jesus then does this. Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So Jesus, on this 7-mile journey with these two followers of his, who don't recognize that it's him, have no idea they're walking with Jesus, and they get this Bible study on this journey. When Jesus begins to teach them how all of the Bible, beginning with Moses and through all of the prophets, all of the Old Testament scriptures, are ultimately and finally about him. In the series, Word Habit, we're talking about what it would look like for us to deepen, or maybe some of us for the first time, develop a daily engagement with scripture, for Bible reading and engagement to be just a part of our regular, everyday lives. And today, we're looking at this conversation that Jesus has. And this conversation he has with them has massive implications for how we understand the Bible, for how we interpret and understand what the Bible is really about, and that's the central question that it answers. What is the Bible really about? Look at what he says next in verses 31 through 32. Check this out. He says, and their eyes, these other followers of him, their eyes were open, and they recognized him, they recognized Jesus, and he vanished from their sight. So, catch that. They eventually get to Emmaus. Jesus breaks bread with them, and then it says their eyes are open. Their eyes are open. They recognize that it was Jesus all along. Imagine the thoughts flashing through their minds. Like, that whole time it was Jesus. Like when we were confused and being fools, that was Jesus the whole time. Their eyes were open, and then it goes on and says, they said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? There's a word that repeats twice in these two verses. It says that their eyes were open, that somehow their eyes were shut. They couldn't see and understand that this was Jesus they were talking to. Their eyes were open, and then they say to each other that this Jesus opened up to them the scriptures. In other words, it's almost like there had been a lock placed on their ability to understand what God was doing. There was a lock in front of them that kept them and prevented them from being able to access all that God wanted to show them. And Jesus opened it up for them. And in so many ways, that is who Jesus is. He is the key that unlocks the entire Bible. It's all about him. This is what Jesus is teaching. He interprets to them, starting with the Old Testament books of the Bible, the first five, the Torah, Then he goes on and talks about the prophets. He describes the writings, the Psalms, and he goes and he describes how all of it is ultimately and finally about him. That means then that the Bible is not primarily about me. The Bible is not primarily about you. The Bible isn't necessarily a rule book that is telling us how we should and shouldn't live, although it has rules. The Bible is not primarily a roadmap or a GPS that teaches us where we should go and what we should do. The Bible, according to Jesus, is ultimately and primarily about him. There's a couple of ways that we see this in Scripture. The first, and maybe the one that's most obvious, is that there's passages of Scripture that are prophetic in nature. What do we mean by that? Well, a prophecy is a message that God inspires someone to deliver that has some predictive power, that has a sense in which they foretell what God is going to do. And so all throughout the Scriptures, there are prophecies about Jesus. Just as an example, Isaiah chapter 8 and 9 describe how Jesus, the Messiah, will be born of a virgin. We hear descriptions about how Jesus is our Prince of Peace, Wonderful Counselor. Isaiah 53 describes the sufferings of Jesus and how he would die. Micah 5 describes how the ruler, this Messiah, would be born in Bethlehem. We have passages like Zechariah chapter 9 that describe how the Messiah would enter into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. There's prophecies all throughout the Bible that describe with predictive power who the Messiah would be. And so in that sense, yes, the Bible is about Jesus. It's pointing us to this Savior. That's not the only way that the Bible points us to Jesus. The narratives of the Bible do this as well. And to do this, I first want to give you a little bit of an illustration, something fun for all of us to engage with. So one of my favorite movies that's a cartoon, Disney-style movie animation is the movie Up. And one of my favorite parts about Up is just the soundtrack. I love listening along to the soundtrack. Sometimes I'll listen to it while I work. And so I actually want to share with you two clips from that. So here's the first one. I'll kind of narrate over it. So we'll play the first one. The most recognizable sound from Up. If you've seen the movie, your ears will jump to that. Well, I want to play for you another song from this movie that captures a different part of the movie. So go ahead and play this clip. Listen to it closely. He's brilliant. The way he writes this soundtrack, the way he writes this and produces this score, is he plays the same melody throughout the song, throughout the movie. The same melody. Dun, 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 dun. Sorry, my voice is horrible. The same melody throughout this. Sometimes it's whimsical and bum, 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 bum. And other times it's like, I'm going to curl up in the fetal position and cry my eyes out because this is so sad, right? What's happening? The same melody, same theme, being played throughout the movie through different instruments. Sometimes it's a lighthearted flute or saxophone. Other times it's a soft, delicate piano. But through different instruments and in different settings, the same melody carried throughout. I want you to think of the Bible similar to that dynamic. God has been playing the same melody throughout redemptive history. God has been revealing himself to humanity. He's been revealing who he is and what he would do. And throughout history, as God has revealed himself, there is a melody throughout the Bible. There's a tone that he strikes, and sometimes he speaks through different instruments and in different settings. Other times it's whimsical and joyful. Other times it's a little bit more dramatic and emotive. But throughout the Bible, God is playing one primary melody throughout the entire Scripture. And I just want to take two Old Testament passages that show this, how God has been playing this tune throughout all of human history and will continue doing so. So Abraham and Isaac's story in Genesis chapter 22 is a prominent story, an important story in the Old Testament. In Genesis chapter 22, God tells Abraham to do something quite shocking. He says, Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son whom you love, and I want you to sacrifice him. I want you to offer him as a sacrifice. And Abraham obeys God and takes his son and goes to the place that God says. So here's what he does. He takes his son Isaac, and he gets some wood, and he lays wood on his back. And he lays wood so that Isaac can carry this wood. And they go on this journey to Moriah, and they climb up this mountain. Now, Moriah is in modern-day Jerusalem. And Abraham and Isaac and some of the people who are part of their household, they go up this mountain on a three-day journey. And when they finally get to the place where they're going to offer the sacrifice, Isaac asks a legitimate question. He says, "Dad, I have the wood here for the offering, but where is the sacrifice? Where is the lamb?" And Abraham looks at his son and says, "God will provide the lamb." So they get to the place, they finally set up the altar, and then Isaac realizes, as his father starts to bind him to that altar, he starts to realize and piece together what's taking place. At this point, Abraham is an old man. Isaac, if he wanted to, could fight off his dad, but Isaac is willing, and he submits to his father's authority. And right then and there, as Abraham is about to strike his son, an angel appears and says, "Abraham, stop." And in that moment, God provides a ram that's caught in a thicket in a thorn bush. And that ram is then taken, the angel instructions, to offer that ram instead of Isaac, his son. Now, we read that story, and without question, that's an incredible story of Abraham's faith, that he knew that if Isaac was the son of the promise, that God had promised him Isaac, that even if Isaac died, Abraham believed God would raise him up from the dead. Abraham sure had tremendous faith. But that story is a recognizable melody. You see, because we know that one day God the Father will walk his son up a mountain in Jerusalem. And this son will carry his own cross, the wood of his cross, up this mountain. And he will be bound to this cross, this instrument of death. And this son, rather than the blade being stopped, this son will die. The soldiers will pierce his side. And Jesus lays down his life, dies for us. The Son of God dies for us in our place. Notice, Abraham said God will provide the lamb. And what was provided was a ram, not a lamb. Because God ultimately provided the true Lamb of God in that moment when Jesus, the true Savior, the true sacrifice, came on that same mountain and laid down his life for us. So Jesus lays down his life, he dies, and on the third day he is delivered from death. 3 days after his death, he is delivered and set free. It's this picture of what God has been doing throughout history, that all of that was ultimately and finally about Jesus. Next, we read about the story of David and Goliath, a common story. David, this unlikely hero, steps up. The entire army of God's people is terrified. They don't want a piece of Goliath. They think they're done for, and in that time period, one of the ways they would battle is they would send forth their greatest warrior, and they would battle it out. One person representing one nation, one person representing the other nation, and no one wanted to go up against Goliath until David walks up and says, "I'll fight him." And he goes up, and he strikes down this giant, defeats the whole entire Philistine army by taking down this one enemy, and the entire nation rejoices. Now, when we read that story, we might say, rightly, David has tremendous faith. What an example to us. And it's beautiful. There's so much to glean from that. But if we insert ourselves in that story, we relate better to the nation of Israel, the rest of the army, that's terrified and wants no part of that enemy. And what's so good about our God is his melody, what he's been doing throughout history, is he sends a hero. He sends someone who can step in and take down the enemy that we can't defeat. And so God sends Jesus, the Son of God, to take on the enemy, sin, death, and the devil. And Jesus defeats that enemy, and by his work for us, the entire people of God share in that victory. You see, the Bible is ultimately and finally about Jesus. So God plays this melody, how he's a rescuing God. He is a God of grace and mercy. He plays this melody all throughout his scripture. So then here's then what this means. If the Bible is all about Jesus, beginning to end, if it's pointing us to Jesus, if it's describing what Jesus has done and then looking forward to when he returns, then here's what this means for us. Three conclusions that we can draw. Number one, life is not about me, it's about God. See, the Bible accurately reflects the nature of the universe. The universe is not about me, it's about God. And so as God speaks, we should observe and we should conclude that God would reflect how he made everything. The Bible is not about me, it's about God, and therefore life is not about me. That is so free. Life is not about you, life is about God. second conclusion we can draw from this is that God is after our worship of Him. This is what He desires. He wants our worship. He wants our delight to be in Him, to be in His Word. See, if the Bible is just a rule book, if the Bible is just a roadmap for how we're to live, that wouldn't drive worship and awe and love for God. But if the Bible is God revealing Himself to us, if the Bible is showing us how desperately we need God, how much He loves us, if that's what the Bible is, showing us the glories of what Jesus has done, that starts to stir our hearts and help us see and appreciate just how amazing Jesus is. And then third, we should read our Bibles expecting God to show us our need for Jesus. We should read our Bibles expecting that what's going to come up as we read, we're going to be prompted, we're going to see, we desperately need a Savior. We are desperately in need of someone to step in and do for us what we can't do for ourselves. And we're going to see that God has made provision for Jesus. God has provided the way that there is grace. He is rich in grace and He is rich in mercy. So as you do your soap method, as you spend time this week daily in Scripture, ask, pray, expect that God is going to show you just how much you need Him. And He'll bring you to this place of awe and wonder at the incredible provision He's given us through Jesus, at the gift of His grace, as we're overwhelmed by all that He's done for us. So before we transition to our discussion time, I'm going to pray for us, and then we'll continue on. Father in heaven, thank You so much that You love us. Thank You that You have not given us just a rule book. You have not given us just a book that has practical advice for us. But Lord, You've given us Your Word that reveals who You are. Lord, You've given us Your Word that opens us up and diagnoses who we are and shows us how You've made a way for us to know You. Thank You, Lord. Our worship belongs to You. Our affections and our desires belong to You. Help us this week to be all about You, to be about Jesus. Help us repent of our selfishness. And Lord, we ask that You would do a great and mighty work in us as we engage with You and as we listen for Your voice. In Jesus' name we pray.